This is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope. AWR
Ghana. Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. I found it hard to believe someone like you cared for me. You put this love in my heart. I tried but could not refuse. You gave me no time to choose. You put this love in my heart. I wanna know where the bad feelings go when I'm depressed and I get down so low. And then I see you coming to me. It's alright. I wanna tell you right now, I'm not afraid to say how you put this love in my heart. There are some times when I doubt, but you always find me out. You put this love in my heart. Cause when I see all that you've done for me, it's hard to doubt, I just got to believe.
Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
To resolve the old issue. The Lord has taken away your sin. 2 Samuel chapter 12 verse 13. There's no point asking God for other things when you haven't made things right with those you need to forgive or ask forgiveness from. Jesus said, "If you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gifts there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gift. Settle matters quickly with your adversary. Don't be led by your wounded ego. Be led by God's word." You say, "But the person I had the issue with is no longer around. I can't get a hearing. Yet in my heart I am still troubled about it." In this case, the Bible says, "Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much." James chapter 5 verse 16. Share your feelings with someone worthy of your trust. Pray with them, openly confessing your wrongs and the guilt you feel. You'll be surprised how prayer and the presence of an affirming friend can provide you with the peace of mind you seek. After David murdered Uriah, his lover's husband, his guilt was overwhelming. It just about wiped him out. When he could take it no more, he broke his silence and sought God's forgiveness. But Uriah wasn't around to hear his confession. He'd been dead almost a year. So David turned to Nathan the prophet and poured out his heart, saying, "I have sinned." Nathan listened patiently and then said, "The Lord has taken away your sin." Follow David's example and then move forward with confidence. This is Abigail in Cancer Mensa. God bless you.
This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
aimlessly beneath the barren sky. Leave it to me, I'll lead you home. So afraid that you will not be found, it won't be long before your sun goes down. Just leave it to me, I'll lead you home.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Youth Corner. My name is Afre Niamakeke. Oftentimes as Christians, we are torn between following our passion and interest and adhering to biblical dictates. It can be quite confusing sometimes distinguishing between what you want and what God desires for you. Today on Youth Corner, we'll be looking at knowing the will of God. My panelists for today are Randolph Efrifa Nanawari and Peter Mensah. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining me on Youth Corner today.
Thank you.
All right. Let's start off by looking at what it means when we say the will of God or something is within the will of God.
The will of God simply deals with knowing what God expects of you. Day in, day out, as human beings, we need to be directed or choose a particular course. However, you need to know God's will to make life easier. If you don't know God's will, you tend to struggle in life and you make a lot of bad choices. But knowing the will of God simply means receiving direction that will make you make right choices in life and achieve your ultimate goal, especially as a Christian, that's making it to heaven.
Oh, okay, so essentially asking for God's direction so that you don't make mistakes and so on and so forth. As you point out, we'll be going much into detail as to how really important it is for a Christian to seek the will of God in all he or she does. But let me seek Randolph's opinion as well as what it means when we say something is within the will of God, an action or an endeavor is in conformity to the will of God by Christian.
The general idea of the will of God is at least you knowing what he needs and you going by that and also doing something to please God. So that is, you can do that by your act, by your speech, by whatever you do that you think as a Christian can influence your relationship with Christ. That is what I know.
So where the confusion comes in most of the time is drawing the line between following your passion or pursuing what becomes your interest and also what God requires of you. For instance, you may need money badly today, okay? You may need a job badly today. You may need a car. I'm just citing examples and instances. But it may not be within the will of God for you to own a car within that period that you may require. How do you then draw the line between what you really need urgently and what the will of God is? Randolph.
Okay, the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom. Therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, present yourself as a living sacrifice to God, holy and acceptable, which is your spiritual act of worship. And do not be conformed any longer to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is, that you may improve what is the will of God. With it, sometimes you will think you need something urgently, but that is not the time. You think you need a car. God also thinks that if he gives you the car, you have an accident. So because God loves us, he wouldn't give you the car so you can go and die. So there are certain things we as human, because of our fleshy needs, our carnal beings, we would think if I had this, it would be best for me. But that wouldn't be good for you in the sight of God.
Let me come to Peter as well. A Christian has been praying for a job for so long. That's an unemployed young person. And all of a sudden, you come across an opportunity. They are calling you to work in a certain company. They are going to pay you so well and all that. And a man of God comes to you and tells you that I've been praying about this, or God has spoken to me and told me working in this company is not his will. What do you do?
And you have to consider the company in question. Are they producing things which are against Christian values and ethics? The fact that somebody comes in God's name doesn't mean you have to just accept whatever he says, hook, line, and sinker. Because We have false prophets and we also have true prophets or men of God. So you have to weigh what he's saying. Test it. Just juxtapose it against the word of God, because whatever he's saying, consider the ramifications. Is it in line with the will of God? And you also have to pray about it yourself. You get it? You have to pray about it yourself, because you can't be sure. It's not everybody who is sent as a man of God or something.
In that particular instance as well, in the absence of, for instance, a man of God coming to you, when you have such an insight, do you have to rush and take the opportunity and say that, well, this is God answering my prayer? Or you have to wait again and seek his will before taking that opportunity?
Well, if it's just a job or an opportunity for you to become rich, why not? You want to grab it because God is concerned about our well-being. If you search the scriptures, you realize that the men of God, a number of them were very rich. Consider Job. He was very rich, richer than any other person in the land. You consider Isaac, who lived in Egypt, and God blessed him to the point that he planted corn and was so rich that they had to sack him. Solomon, and all of them were very rich. So if there's an opportunity for you to get rich or improve your life, provided the means to getting it is not against the will of God, it's okay. Because God encourages hard work. As a matter of fact, some of the people who have been very hardworking in the history of this world is the Israelites. They are very hardworking.
All right, this leads me to our next question. Just before we also look at the importance of seeking or knowing the will of God. Of course, you did give hints of that in your introduction where you defined what the will of God is. Let me find out from Randolph, how do you get to know that this is the will of God? Does it come by some sort of miraculous or supernatural action or occurrence?
God works in so many ways. God can let someone tell you or can reveal it to someone to extend information to you. But when the information comes, you as a child of God, you can also make further inquiries from God. So with that, you need to maintain a good relationship with God so that when the instruction comes, if it's from God, definitely you know, because he wouldn't hide anything from you. If he needs you to do something, he will reveal it to you. If you also go in prayer and you ask of it, he'll get it for you. So God has different ways of communicating to us. One, as I said, it can come through a dream. You can have it through a dream. Maybe by extension, someone can also come and inform you that this is what God has revealed to me about you. Any other ways too, you can also be there. And since you have put in a petition before him, you have to continue by praying, by asking, maybe by any sign, that some signs for you to understand that truly this is what you want me to do. So in a nutshell, God has a whole way of communicating depending on what he wants to give you.
All right, Peter, how do you know the will of God?
The will of God is quite very simple. In the first place, when you read Proverbs 19:21, it says, many are the plans in a man's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. So for you to actually appreciate or quickly know the will of God, you must soften your heart. Many a time Christians have hard and fast rules. We want things to go in a certain way. We have made plans for God. You get it? And when it happens that way, it's very difficult for you to know. But we also get to know the will of God through outcomes of events. Certain things happen to you and you wonder, why is it happening? It's happening so because that's the way God wants it to happen. Because it is God who is in charge. Things, if he doesn't want certain things to happen to you, he will not let it happen. And that's why the Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians 5:18 that in everything, give thanks to God. So you get to know through the outcome of events. Yes, and also through vision, dreams, and also God speaks to individuals around us.
Yeah,
we get to know through that as well.
Of course, I have met Christians who, in trying to discern really what becomes or what is the will of God, they may say they don't see any of these things coming up. What would you say to them, just finally?
They have to intensify their prayers, because if you go to the book of James chapter 4:8, it says, draw closer to God and he also draw closer to you. If you live in the flesh and you are not drawing closer to God, you not get to understand some of the things he communicates.
Okay, so essentially, drawing closer to God will enable you to know what really his will is in all situations. On that note, we end this edition of Youth Corner. My name is Afrenia Makeke. I've been here with Peter Mensah and Randolph Efrifa Nanoware as my panelists. Thank you for listening. Hear me, call me, hear me,
is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice
of Hope. We will bring you joy. Keep hope alive.
You can contact us on
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058.
Thank you very much. You are the Savior with the spiritual touch. Praise your holy name. Since you've touched my life, I've never been the same.
Well, in my darkness,
you are my light.
Pain and confusion,
you guide me aright.
I sing sweet Jesus,
you are the Christ.
And in my blindness,
you're such a beautiful sight. Thank you very much. You are the Savior with the spiritual touch. Praise your holy name. Since you've touched my life, I've never been the same.
Well, in my darkness,
you are my light.
Pain and confusion,
you guide me aright.
I sing sweet Jesus,
you are the Christ.
And in my blindness,
you're such a beautiful sight. Thank you very much. You are the Savior with the spiritual touch. Praise your holy name. Since you've touched my life, I've never been the same.
Well, in my darkness,
you are my light.
Fading confusion,
calling for you and for me.
Calling for you and
on the portal, he's waiting and watching, watching for you. And
my dear listener, I bring you greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want us to look at something in the Holy Bible, in the book of Matthew, chapter 5 and verse 3. The book of Matthew, chapter 5, contains what we call the Beatitudes, or Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. The very first part contains the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes are a list of blessings that Jesus Christ pronounced on certain class of people. And the one that is in verse 3 is the poor in spirit. And so I want to entitle this Poor but blessed. Poor but blessed. Because we are talking about the poor in spirit. Matthew chapter 5 verse 3 says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Jesus was talking to a group of people gathered around him, and his disciples were with him. And on this Sermon on the Mount, Jesus was trying to bring out these traits for us to know what we are supposed to be. And one of them is, we should be poor in spirit. What does it mean to be poor in spirit? Of course, Jesus was trying to contrast what a true believer should be to what the people of those days were. And the people of today. So he was to say that, look, do not be like what the world is. You have to be different. You have to be poor in spirit. And by being poor in spirit, what do we mean? And the reward is actually the kingdom of God. So another way of putting the question is, how do I get the kingdom of God? How do I inherit the kingdom of heaven? I can inherit the kingdom of heaven by being poor in spirit. How can I develop this attitude? I want you to go with me to the book of James, chapter 4, and we will read from verse 7 to verse 10. That is how you can cultivate the attitude of being poor in spirit. James chapter 4, verses 7 through 10. James says, submit yourselves to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning, and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. We are talking about the Holy Spirit here, and we are talking about being poor in the Holy Spirit. We are talking about a situation where you do not have the spirit of your own unless you submit yourself to God. And that is the only time that you can inherit the kingdom of heaven. So being poor in spirit, we are talking about a situation where you come to God. Coming to God. So how can I come to God? James gives us five ways. One, he says, submit to God. Yield to his authority and his will. Commit your life to him and to his control, and he will take charge of everything. Commit your will to God. Commit your life to him. Commit your everything to his control, and you should be willing to follow him. That is what you should do. So how can I come near to God? Submit to God. Do not let anything be yours. Just tell God, God, I have come to you. There's nothing I can do on my own. I am poor in spirit. You are the only one who can make me rich in spirit. The second way that we can come to God, James says, we should resist the devil. Resist the devil. Don't allow Satan to entice and tempt you. When the devil comes to say, man, there's some money there you can embezzle, tell him, you devil, get away from me. I belong to God. When the devil says, look, that man's wife is there, you can go into her. Of course, she has brought herself. Tell the devil, you devil, get away from me. I am God's child. I do not belong to you. Whatever suggestions the devil brings to you, James says, resist the devil. Don't allow him to entice you. Don't allow him to tempt you. The third thing that we are to do to come close to God is wash your hands, purify your hearts. That's what James says. That is, lead a pure life. Attempt to lead a pure life. Be cleansed from sin. Replace your desire to sin with your desire to experience God's purity. Get close to God and be pure with him. And by that, we can say you are poor in spirit, and you can inherit the kingdom of God. The fourth point that I want to give is grief and mourn and wail in sincere sorrow for your sin. So being poor in spirit, James says, grief and mourn and wail. And this grieving and mourning and wailing has to do with crying for the sins that you commit. Make sure you are sorry for the sins that you commit. For that money that you took, for that crime that you committed, make sure your sorrow towards the sin is sincere. And that's why James says, grief and mourn and wail. Make sure it is a heartfelt sorrow. The last point is, humble yourself before the Lord. And then the reward is, he will lift you up. Praise God. The moment you humble yourself, he will lift you up. That's James chapter 4, verse 10. If you want to look it further, look at it in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6. Humble yourself before the Lord and he will lift you up. So make yourself poor in spirit and the Lord will make you rich in spirit. He will lift you up and your reward will be the kingdom of heaven. So you will be blessed even though you are poor. May God bless you and may he make you really blessed even as you submit your will to him. Submit to him, resist the devil, wash your hands and purify your hearts, lead a pure life, grieve and mourn and wail in sincere sorrow for your sins, humble yourself before the Lord, and he will lift you up. by making you to inherit the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom of heaven. May God bless you. Thank you very much for listening. I am Pastor Josiah Ando. God bless you.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo and Senedu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you.